Well, we look ahead now to 1965, and Australia challenged for the first time for the Admirals Cup out of this club, CYC, and Caprice of Huon with skipper Gordon Ingate was one of the team, along with Freya and Camille. Just tell us about that experience. I mean, we were pioneers and we went over there with great success, especially from Caprice of Huon.
Well, of course, when we left here to go and challenge for the Admirals Cup, we knew that we were beginners. And from all the information that we were able to receive, we thought, wow, we're just going over there for the first time to learn what it's all about so that we can proceed and do better. We knew that we were going with older boats, older designs, and not very much experience, in our opinion. But the team that was put together, after, you know, we tried very hard with our best boats at the time, and we had the Elimination Series, and it was great racing. The Elimination Series was probably some of the best racing we'd done, because we went up and we trained up in Pittwater, up in the Hawkesbury River, to try and get some knowledge of currents, because we were never involved in sailing in currents. Well, we knew we were going to be sailing in these currents of England, and so we did a lot of practice up there, and the racing, as I say, that we did before we left to choose the team was very, very tough. And we in Caprice of Huon, we made it by 1 point by being better than Salacia, who was a brand new boat, very well sailed, designed by Sparkman and Stevens, and very well built, and we had some exciting races. And it was a difficult decision for the committee to pick us, because they said, look, Caprice of Huon, she's 13 years old, she's an old design, and we're having trouble picking it. And Merv Davey, who was at this stage the secretary, said the rules of the contest was the people that got the lowest points would be picked. Caprice has got 1 point better than Salacia, and they picked us. We were very pleased, because we thought we were not going to be picked. And so off we went, and it was just great when you think that we went there for the first time and it hardly cost us any money. Yeah, we managed to have sponsors by Qantas picked up the tab for our airfares and the shipping company. We went on freighters. The Vesti family picked up the freight, and generally the whole thing was well sponsored. The cigarette company picked up a major sponsorship by our then Commodore that was involved in the tobacco industry. And of course, our major sponsor, I think, was
Sir James Kirby.
Same James. And Sir James accompanied the team over, and he was a great ambassador for Australia. Anyway, we arrived in England not without some difficulty. We had to sail the boats across from Dunkirk. And we arrived, and the English press got onto us fairly quickly and said, wasn't it great for the Colonials to take part in their International Admirals Cup race, to bring over three old design boats, and we welcome them and hope that they enjoy our sailing. Never forget the first race. Number one, that we discovered how cold England can be. I actually made the statement, boy, if I lived in England, I'd give up yachting. It was so cold and miserable. The very first race, we were approaching the start line, and I said to Bill Fesk, and thank heavens that Bill Fesk was our navigator, fantastic navigator. I said, Bill, we're too early. He says, Gordon, go for the start. And I said, but Bill, like, there's nobody within 5 minutes of the start line. He said, you go for the start. I know what I'm doing. Okay. We hit the start line, going maximum spinnaker up the hole. And I guarantee the nearest English boat, and by the other two Australians, by the way, were taking notice of the English fleet. They were exactly 5 minutes behind at the start with a, this is not good. It was around the island race. And we, the bigger boats, and there were 70 footers in the race, were, they didn't pass us until the needles coming back into the, so we'd gone two thirds the way around the race and nobody had caught us. Headlines. Australian boat gets lucky break. Congratulations, but the racing's yet to start. This was just around the, and that was winning the Queen Victoria Trophy. This trophy I couldn't get my arms around. And so we go out then for the next race, which was the across the Channel race, the Channel race. And again, we weren't passed until we got to Horsand Fort, and the start was up in near the Hamble. And we had a great race across to the Le Havre buoy, and we managed to get around it extremely well, again because of Bill Fesk. Navigation was spot on, and the currents were severe. Mm. We were experiencing 3.5 knots at the Le Havre buoy, and it was difficulty getting around. Anyway, we came back and found that we'd won the Channel race, which we thought, wow, yeah, the old girl's doing all right. And the press gets on. Australia knows, had a lucky break across the Channel. The wind changed as they got to Le Havre and were able to get round first. Then comes the Britannia Cup. And we raced around in the Solent, and Bill Fesk really knew how the Solent worked. And when we came ashore after winning the Britannia Cup, the press said, "These Australians race too hard. We have to teach them that we go out sailing for a jolly." Like the idea is if somebody blows a starting gun, we like to hear the next gun, which is the finishing gun. And we thought, uh-oh, what are we doing wrong here? And anyway, winning the Britannia Cup, and then, of course, the next race was the New York Yacht Club Cup. And that was our most exciting race of the lot, because we didn't get a good start, and we were playing catch-up the whole time. And we arrived at the East Ride buoy, and I said, "Bill, I think we're in about 150th position." He says, "We're 154. And I said, "Oh, well, we'll see what we can do." He said, "Now, I want you to do exactly as I tell you." I said, "Okay, Bill." I said, "Everybody's tacked off onto Port Tack, and they're going up towards Southampton." He said, "We're not going to do that. We're going off on starboard, right up into Osborne Bay." I said, "Oh, okay. That means we're the only boat doing it." So we went up into Osborne Bay. He said, I said, "We must be nearly aground." And he said, "Yes, there's only about a foot of water underneath that cliff." He said, "But we're completely out of the current. There is no current here. As a matter of fact, I'm detecting an opposite going current." We tacked and went around Osborne Point, and as we tacked onto starboard tack heading up towards Cowes, and we were on starboard, and all the boats coming out of Southampton water, out of that area of the Solent, were taking our stern. They were being thrown back by the current. We actually had the current going with us, and they were all being, we passed 150 boats, including The one that really gave me the greatest of pleasure to pass was Buzz Mosbacher was sailing a boat called Caper, a 72-foot brand new sloop designed by Sparkman and Stevens, and we beat him across the finishing line. And we won the New York Yacht Club Cup. And all of a sudden, Caprice of Huon is the toast of cows and the toast of English yachting and all the rest of it. And the English press took the exact opposite approach. We're going to have to watch these colonials. They're giving us a sailing lesson. Because both Freya and Camille, which they were sailing for, they were just being extremely well sailed, and they were keeping up the points, and at this stage we were leading points, except Freya had made a mistake of sailing around wrong, but took a wrong course in the cup. And it was very interesting that Ron Swanson had finished the race and found that he was told by somebody, hey, you didn't go around so-and-so, Mark. He went and resailed the entire course. Took him another 4 hours to do it, and claimed that he had finished sailing the course, and he got 2 valuable points. But Freya said, oh, we're not going to do it, and lost the 2 points. Mm. And those 2 points cost us the Admirals Cup in 1965, which was a great... We did very well in the Fastnet race, and one of the things, I bought a photograph of us going round the Fastnet Rock. And a funny little story there. I was told by John Illingworth, he was there to welcome us and the rest of it. He said, Gordon, don't forget to pay the toll at Fastnet Rock. I said, what do you mean pay a toll at Fastnet Rock? He said, there's a guy there that requires a shilling toll. And I said, oh, come on, what's all this about? And he said, King Brian, the king of the Irish small people, he gets his money from, you've got to pay him an English shilling as you go around the rock. I said, oh, okay. So I got an English shilling. And we were fairly close, and it was a lovely day going around the rock. So I stood up on the stern of Caprice of Huon, and I said, King Brian, here's your toll. And I can't do it very well at the moment, but my right hand, I threw it as hard as I could, and my Rolex watch went...
Nah.
And to this day, my Rolex watches.
Is that right? At the bottom of the Irish Sea?
At the Fastnet Rock. I said, King Brian, you little bastard, she had got more than the toll. And truly, that's
what
exactly what it would happen.
Wow.
And so we did very well in the Fastnet race.
And of course, 2 years later, Caprice went again, but you were involved with the Americas coming at that stage.
Because I'd done well in the 65 thing, so Frank Packer sent me a letter and said, would I join his 12-metre team? Mm. And I thought, wow, this is something. So I did, I joined. That was in 65. And what had happened then, of course, I said to Gordon Reynolds, I said, look, Gordon, please take the boat. Mm. You know, you can organise a crew. And he had Graham Mullins again, and Bill Fesk, and part of the winning team, which was just great. They did very well with the old sails. I think Gordon did buy himself, they bought a new Genoa for the boat, but that was all. And they did remarkably well. Again, Bill Fesk, he was just phenomenal, what he could do with the navigation over there.
Well, let's talk about the 71 Sydney Hobart race in Caprice of Huon. 72, I'm sorry. 72,
oh,
yes.
Do you think I should talk about
I want you to talk about it. Let me set the scene. The race was won by American Eagle, Lion and Handicap. But for a long time, Caprice of Huon looked the winner.
Came second.
That's right, came second. Over to you. Where should the race finish?
Well, I'm going to probably, because this is history, only a couple of people that know this particular story. Anyway, Caprice had been doing extremely well in ocean racing, mainly because of the old age allowance. And because the boat's getting on in years at this stage, but I was keeping it going as best I could under with a limited budget at this stage. Being involved in the America's Cup was taking a bit of a, also on the 5.5s. I'd given Dragons away at the time. Anyway, we went down to the Hobart race and Billy Manning, along with Jim Robson Scott, were co-navigators. And neither of them let on to me that in their navigation prowess, we'd come on the radio and give our position report. And at this stage, we're being shown us in the bunch of the, at the end of the fleet. And I'm saying, hey, come on, guys, what's going on? We're doing better than that. And they said, oh, well, all the others are putting on, they're being a little bit positive in their outlooks and they're a long way ahead of us, but we'll catch them, don't worry. I said, but there's Ted Kaufman's boat and Jeff Lee. I can see them. They're putting themselves on 40 miles ahead of us. They said, oh, well, we're not putting anything in for current. I said, come on. The idea of reporting our position is for a safety situation. You know, if anything happens to us, where are they going to start looking? I said, you better start. And by the way, the ABC, we're hearing the ABC report, Caprice of Huon was supposed to be doing well and she's dropping back. She's not doing at all well. And I said, come on, guys, you're going to have to start putting it on. Next ABC report. Caprice of Huon's hit a favourable breeze and has gained 40 miles on the flight. 40? I said, Jesus, you can't put 40 miles on. Anyway, leaving Green Cape, you know, we're alongside Jeff Lee, and he was always the boat from our point of view because he was a new Peter Cole boat and we rated very similarly. Anyway, we beat him to Hobart. And we came ashore and they said, look, we've done some calculations and you've come second to American Eagle. I'm a very good friend, Ted Turner. I met Ted way back in 1967 winning the 5.5s. And I think the winning margin was, we can look it up in the records, but I think the winning margin was 6 minutes. Very close. Mm. It was close, right? But yeah, the Hobart race has been, had closer finishes than that. And we came back and started ocean racing again. And our first ocean race coming back was the Flinders Island race. And a new boat was in it, Patrice, sailed by the Kirby family with Peter Fletcher on board as tactician. And it was great. Caprice of Huon beat the new boat, bigger boat. And we beat him boat for boat down there and back. And the results come out and we thought we'd won the race. We'd done our calculations. And Gordon Marshall, who was the guy at the time, he said, no, Gordon, you didn't win this race. I said, why? You know, he said, because we've altered your age allowance. I said, what do you order an age allowance for? You only order the age allowance if we've had a win, or a second, or a third, and you know, the age allowance. He said, you've won the Hobart race, and so we've altered your age allowance for this race. I said, what do you say that again? Come back to me. We did a calculation on the age allowance of American Eagle and she was wrong. She was given 3 years age allowance and she's only been given 2 years age allowance. And you beat American Eagle by 22 minutes. I said, you're having me on. He said, no. That's why we've altered your age allowance for this race. So the official record shows that Caprice of Huon won the Hobart race in 1972. And that can be checked.
Wow. That's not known to too many people.
It's not known at all. Gordon Marsham died with taking it to the grave with him. And you can imagine I was a bit disappointed.
Mm.
And they said, and by the way, this brings up a very interesting point. I said, well, okay, are we going to alter anything? And they said, no, you can't alter anything. The only way you could have done anything was you protested the race result. And I said, right, from now on in, I'm going to fly the protest flag at every start I go in, because I believe it was the second time that a rating cost me a place in the Hobart race. In 1951, Merv Davey was the measurer, and I couldn't understand why a 28-footer was giving a 34-footer time. We were giving Ellard a time, and I said, oh, something radically wrong somewhere. And Merv Davey also thought it was a bit peculiar, and he checked my rating certificate of Jasner, and the J dimension on Jasner was 10 feet, and he had it down at 12 foot 6.
Wow. Wow.
That gave us third in the Hobart race in 1950.
A few controversial decisions there.
Yeah, and they say, well, the only way it can be altered is you've got to protest. That means you've got to protest by the finish of the race. So
yes, yeah.
Wow. I started with the protest flag, and I said, well, look, what else can I do?
Yeah.
And basically then, in 1972, I gave up ocean racing.
Mm.
The reason being, two things decided that. I thought, oh, well, look, I suppose I was getting a bit long in the tooth for ocean racing, and I was enjoying the 5.5s. And let's face it, then challenge for the America's Cup in 77. So I was very much into 12 metre sailing. And I think that I kept Caprice of Huon really on the mooring, and boy. So here I was, what, sailing a 5.5 when I could, sailing at 12 metres more than anything else, and I get a phone call. I've got Caprice of Huon on the mooring as well, not doing very much. And I get this phone call from Sir Alexis Albert. He says, Gordon. He said, yeah. I said, yes, Sir Alexis. He said, I want you to have my boat. I said, Sir Alexis, thank you very much. I love your boat. It's a beautiful boat. He says, yes, the only person I can think of that I'd like to have my boat. So it's for sale to you only. On one condition. I said, oh, Sir Alexis, what's that? He says, I'm keeping the name, Norn.
Mm-hmm.
So what do? Oh, dear. I buy Norn, and so I've got to change the name. So I changed the name to Nina, my dear darling mother-in-law, who was responsible for me being involved in this type of sailing. She supported me all the way, which was just great. And so there I am. I called the boat Nina.
Mm.
Who did I upset? My mother. Whose name was Greta. So she thought. So. Anyway, Nina was great, and of course...
But we've got some Olympic Games thrown in at the time,
oh,
too,
yeah, 1972,
yeah,
sailing
for the tennis.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah, just,
yeah.
Just to keep the kettle boiling away. Yeah. Oh, quite crazy. Yes, I was doing a lot of sailing.
Yeah.
A lot of sailing. But there are other stories that don't really connect with the Cruising Yacht Club of Australia, and I've kept up the membership.
Mm.
I've been disappointed many times. But the disappointment, I suppose, finally came as the crunch of when Gordon Marshall should never have told me.
No.
If he had just taken it to the grave with him,
yeah.
I would have been perfectly happy.
Yeah.
But then the other thing that really put me off was the IOR rule that then came into being. And I saw this guys with the way the designs were going, with guys sitting on the rail.
Mm.
At my age, I'm saying, this is not for me. I'm not going to sit on the rail, and not only that, I'm not going to ask my crew to sit on the rail. If this is the way yachting's going, and it's gone from what? From the IOR rule to now, to me, to see guys sitting with their backs to the action and just being used as rail meat is quite contrary to my starting off as a cruising yachtsman. Started off as a cruising yachtsman at the tender age of 16.
Well, here you are at 86, still sailing, you're still racing a dragon.
Yes, gone back to dragons. Fantastic. And I enjoy the dragon quite dramatically. And I rely every now and then for very nice people to invite me out on their boats.
Lovely.
Gretel 2 has been refitted, and Mike Maxwell invited me out last Wednesday, and it was a superb day to go out sailing on the old girl, and she's been beautifully rebuilt. And I've got to thank David Chantelou for looking after Caprice of Huon and keeping it going. She is a very famous boat and will be for a long, long time.
Well, Gordon, it's been great talking to you, one of Australia's famous yachtsmen and a long-time member of the CYC. It's been a real privilege. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter.